Hello again. This is the 6 day online Bible school. My name is Maurice Barratt and I'm here with another study. They're taken from this book. It's the third one in the series, Fulfilling the Law. We've been through, Will the Real Christians Please Stand Up? We've been through Salt and Light, the character of a disciple. And now we're up to a difficult passage really in the Sermon on the Mount. I'm going to read it, the four verses in a minute. But if you've not got the book, you can get it from our website, which is www.barrattministries.org.uk. And it's available as a paperback, PDF, or Amazon Kindle download. Let me read you the passage we're looking at. This is Matthew chapter 5, verse 17. Think not. Don't think that I've come to destroy the law or the prophets. I've not come to destroy, but to fulfil. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled. Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments, and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say unto you, except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the Pharisees and scribes, ye shall in no case enter the kingdom of heaven. Well, difficult, because many Christians who are under grace have said that we don't need the law anymore. But Jesus says, I've not come to destroy the law or the prophets. So what does he mean? Well, last study, I can't go into it, but we looked at the law and we found that the Bible says the law is perfect. Paul says the law is just and holy and righteous. And we found the problem was not the law. The law exposes us as sinners, but the problem is sin, because sin uses the law to condemn us. If there's no law, there's no sin. Sin can't be imputed without a law. So you make a law and people who break it suffer the punishment. So we found that we're freed from the curse of the law. We're not freed from the law, but the curse, the penalty for breaking it. That's the curse of the law. But I need to stress the ceremonial law, the sacrifices, the washing of hands, the special feast days, the special days, all that is done away with. I'm talking about the moral law of God, the Ten Commandments. That stands and will stand till heaven and earth pass. So we're not talking about the ceremonial law. We're not talking about the Torah. We don't have to keep the Torah, because that includes all the sacrifices. It includes the feasts. It includes so many things. If you look at Leviticus, it says divers laws and sundry ordinances. Those are all done away with. We're talking about the moral law of God. But Jesus says, I've not come to destroy it, but to fulfil it. So how do we fulfil the law? If we're like Jesus and we have to fulfil the law, how do we fulfil it? Well, one word could describe it. Love fulfils the law. Let's have a look at some scriptures. Mark chapter 12. We read this last week, so this is tying up from last week. Mark chapter 12. And verse 28. One of the scribes came to Jesus, having heard them reasoning together, and perceived that he answers well. Jesus has answered them well. And he asked him, which is the first commandment of all? And I said last study that he didn't mean number one, thou shalt not kill, or whatever the first one is. He meant, which is the first, the most important? And Jesus said, the first or the most important of all the commandments is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and you shall love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. Love, 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 love. Love God with all your heart, love God with all your soul, love God with all your mind, and love God with all your strength. And Jesus says, and I'll throw the second one in as well. The second most important is like this. very similar, thou shalt love thy neighbour as yourself. There is none other commandment greater than these. And a scribe said to him, well, master, you've said the truth, for there is one God, and there is none other but he. And to love him with all the heart, and with all the understanding, and with all the soul, and with all the strength, and to love your neighbour as yourself, is more than the whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. This was a man who was still under the law. He was still under the burnt offerings and sacrifices, and yet he had revelation. When Jesus said that, he said, wow, master, you've said well. To love God and love your neighbour, it's more than the whole burnt sacrifices and offerings. He suddenly got it and he was still under the law. And when Jesus saw, he answered discreetly, wisely, with revelation, he said, wow, you're not far from the kingdom of God. You've got some revelation. And no man dare ask him questions after that. So this is Jesus, still under the old covenant, telling them that that's how you will fulfil the law. And this scribe got it. And we saw last week that when you studied the Ten Commandments, just the bold statements, thou shalt not kill, it needs explanations. Because God told Israel to go and kill their enemies. You're supposed to kill meat to eat, kill animals to eat. So when thou shalt not kill doesn't mean anything unless you have revelation. So the rest of Leviticus, it tells you how to apply thou shalt not kill. And all the commandments are like that. And God starts to bring emotions in to the dead letter. And thou shalt love thy neighbour as thyself. That's Leviticus chapter 19, verse 19. So this is under the law, the very, you know, book Leviticus with all the ordinances and divers different situations. It brings love into the law. So even under the old covenant, the law was always meant to be kept by faith and love. We saw last week there was a connection between faith and love. And I want to emphasise that again this week. Well, that was Jesus. You could say he was under the old covenant. The scribes and Pharisees were under the old covenant. And I would agree. So let's look at the epistles. Let's look at what Paul, Peter, different apostles said. Now that Jesus had died, now they're under grace. When Jesus said that to the scribes and the Pharisees, they weren't under grace. They were still under the law. And yet Jesus was showing them that love would fulfil the law under the old covenant. And under the new. So Romans chapter 13. The chapter starts off, let every soul be subject to the higher power. In other words, obey those in authority. And verse 6, pay tribute to whom it's due. Render to all their dues, verse 7. Verse 8, owe no man anything. Now I'm coming to it. Oh, no man anything but to love one another. For he that loveth hath fulfilled the law. So how can the law be done away with if we fulfil it? Jesus says, I've not come to destroy it. I've come to fulfil it. I've come to show you what my father really meant when he gave the law to Moses. It was never a dead letter. It was never something that they couldn't keep. The moral law of God was meant to be kept by his people. And you fulfil it by love and faith. He that loveth another hath fulfilled the law. And he gives us examples from the moral law. For this thou shalt not commit adultery. So he's referring to what I've said, the moral law. He's not talking about sacrifices. He's talking about the moral law. For this thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness. Thou shalt not covet. That's the Ten Commandments. And if there's any other commandment, it's briefly comprehended in this saying, love your neighbour as yourself. That covers everything, loving your neighbour. If I love my neighbour, I won't kill him. If I love my neighbour, I won't steal his wife and sleep with her. If I love my neighbour, I won't be jealous or envious if he gets a new car. If I love my neighbour, I won't bear false witness. If you love your neighbour, you'll fulfil all the law. What's so difficult about the Ten Commandments? I can't understand Christians who say, oh, nobody can keep the moral law of God, it's too hard. Well, do you have to kill? Do you have to commit adultery? It's so difficult. Do you have to bear false witness? Do you have to lie? Do you have to cheat? What's the problem? But you see, we're like our sin. And so we rubbish the law because the law condemns us. If you're righteous, you love the law. People who love the law love God. David, although he was a weak man, he was a man after God's own heart. And he says, oh, how I love thy law. I meditate in it day and night. It's my delight. I'll run the way of your commandments. It's not grievous. The law of God, the moral law, if you love God. It's grievous if you don't love. It's grievous to love your neighbour if you hate him, if you don't love. Love is the key. Faith and love are the key to the victorious Christian life. And if there's any other commandments, he briefly comprehended in this saying, love your neighbour as yourself. Love worketh no ill to his neighbour. Therefore, conclusion, love is the fulfilling of the law. I mean, we may as well all go home. It's finished. What more can I say? Well, I'm going to say more because I want to renew your mind. I want to get it into your mind that the law of God is wonderful, the moral law of God. Let's see what James says. Here's another apostle. People say that James is very tough. He's very strong. He calls love in the world spiritual adultery. He talks about the tongue and how wicked it is. But what does he talk about this principle? James chapter 2, verse 8. James calls it the royal law, the regal way. If you fulfil the royal law according to the scripture, thou shalt love thy neighbour as thyself, you do well. So James calls it the royal law. This is the kingly way to live. But if you have respect to persons, you commit sin, and are convinced of sin as transgressors. For whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point is guilty of all. For he that said, don't commit adultery, said also, don't kill. Now, if you commit no adultery, yet if you kill, you become a transgressor of the law. So speak ye and so do as they that shall be judged by the law of liberty. The law of liberty. This royal law, this frees you. If you're trying to keep the dead letter, you've got to keep the whole law, because if you don't kill, but you covet something, then you've broken the law, you're a lawbreaker. But it says, so live and so do. Christianity is not what you believe, it's how you live. So live, so do, as though you're going to be judged by this royal law of liberty. It says, what do they profit, my brethren, though a man say, have faith and have not works? Faith and love, you can apply the same principles. They're both verbs. They're something you do. Faith is the evidence of things that you believed in your head. And love is something that you demonstrate. It's no point saying you love. That's feelings. Love has to be demonstrated. It's a verb. It's something you do. Love is what you do, not what you feel. It's not what you believe. You can say, I love everybody. But unless you manifest it in your lifestyle, you love nobody, you love yourself. Love gives. If you're a taker, you're not a lover. Lust takes, love gives. So love is demonstrative, faith is demonstrative. You've got to have the evidence of love, you've got to have the evidence of faith. So he's pushing the point. He says, what does it profit, my brothers, though a man says he has faith and have not works, no manifestation? Can faith save him? In other words, can believe it, it's just in your head. If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say, depart in peace, be warmed and filled, but you don't give him those things which are needed, you don't buy him a Big Mac that's needful to the body, what does it profit? Even so, faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone. Love without manifestation, without fulfilling the law, isn't love. Love fulfills the law. So if you're not fulfilling the law, it's a lack of love, a lack of faith. Yea, a man may say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without your works. You can't. Show me your love without demonstration. It's as crazy as a girl saying, oh, I'm in love, Maurice. And I say, that's wonderful. Who's the lucky man? Oh, I don't love anyone, I'm just in love. It's ridiculous. You've got to love something. Love your car, love your cat, love your husband, love your wife. You can't just be in love. It doesn't make sense. And to say I believe in God doesn't make sense. There's got to be some works to prove that you have faith. There's got to be some person to demonstrate your love to. Well, James calls it the royal law. This is the regal, the kingly way to live, the royal law. Love your neighbour as yourself. So we fulfil the law by what we do, not by how or what we believe. Love can only be demonstrated by outward actions. So why don't Christians love the neighbour as herself? I don't expect those who don't know God to do it. They've got their own code of conduct. They might be good, they might be bad, they might be looking after themselves, they may be very caring for other people. But I'm talking about people who want to have the character of Christ, people who want to be disciples. And I'll tell you why. It's very costly. Very, very costly to love your neighbour as yourself. To love your neighbour as much as you love yourself is very, very difficult. There's some preachers who say that, well, you've got to love yourself first before you can love others. Love others as you love yourself. So you start by loving yourself. That is contrary to the whole tenor of the Bible. That's contrary to the Word of God. It never means that at all. In fact, the Bible says that no man hates himself. Everybody loves himself. That's your problem. That's my problem. I love myself. It's all about self. That's why we have to deny self, because we love ourselves. I want to please me. I'll please you as long as it pleases me as well. But to please you when it doesn't please me is costly. To love you as much as I love me. Well, I use the illustration often and I'm not apologising for that. I'll use it again. Matthew chapter 19. The rich young ruler. He couldn't pay the price. Matthew 19, verse 16. And behold, one came and said to Jesus, "Good master, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life?" You say that's works. Of course it is. But works can prove your faith. Faith without works is dead. Christians are frightened of this sort of teaching. But Cornelius was commended by God for what he did. It said, your almsgiving, your prayer and your fasting, that's works, have come up before me as a memorial. And he said to the angel, go and show Cornelius the way of salvation. And he met Paul, as it happens, and Paul showed him the way to have salvation. But his almsgiving, his prayer and fasting, his works came up. It wasn't his works that got him the revelation. The works proved his faith. He who believes is obedient. He who is obedient believes. He did the works of faith. So he was justified by faith. It was faith, not his works. But works can prove your faith. Faith without works isn't faith. So you need to get the balance. What good things shall I do? What can I do to prove my faith? That I may have eternal life. So he's asking for eternal life. And God said, if you'll enter into life, you want eternal life, keep the commandments. And he said unto him, which? Well, all of them, obviously. But the moral law of God, again, he didn't say sacrifice, keep the feast. He never said keep the feast. He never talked about the ceremonial law. He talked about the moral law of God. This is fundamental. Forget all the other feasts and the ceremonies. That's all done away with now. Even for the Jews it's done away with. There's no temple anymore. There's no priest. There's no altar. There's no holiest of holies. There's no Ark of the Covenant. It's all finished. Even for a Jew, he cannot keep it, even if he wants. A Jew who wants to keep the law cannot keep the ceremonial law of God. He can't keep Passover. He can't keep the feast because they've got to offer sacrifices. They can't do it. Which ones? Thou shalt do no murder, do not kill, thou shalt not commit adultery. He's going through the moral law of God. Don't steal. Honour the father and thy mother. Verse 20. The young man said, all these things I've kept from my youth up, I've done those. He had his ticket to eternal life. He was justified by faith if he did them by faith. But he asked a question. He says, what do I lack? I wish Christians had asked that. I'm saved, baptised in water, speak with tongues. What do I lack? A lot. Your character isn't like Christ. You lack a lot. Those are just the foundations. Paul says, let's go on to perfection. Not laying again the foundations of baptisms and salvation and all those things. Those are basics. What do I lack? Jesus said, if you will be perfect, mature, go and sell what you have, give to the poor, and you'll have treasures in heaven, and come and follow me. And when the young man heard it, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. I say it every time I go through it. You'd imagine a young man would go away angry. Fancy Jesus asking me to give everything away. I'm rich. He knows I'm rich. Why would he ask me to give everything away? I've kept the law. I've done all that. But he went away sorrowful. He wanted to do it, but he couldn't. It was too big a price. And he went away sorrowful. He didn't want to be perfect. He wanted salvation. But when Jesus says, if you want to be perfect, if you want to be mature, if you want to be like your Father in heaven, you've got to start loving your neighbour as much as you love yourself. And you're very rich. And there's a lot of poor people in the world. So if you love the poor people as much as you love yourself, you don't want to be poor. So you wouldn't be able to sleep at night that people are poor. You'd have to share your wealth with them. He exposes lack of love. It's interesting, you know. When he said which commandments, Jesus said, don't murder, don't commit adultery, don't steal, honour your father and the mother. And then he added something that wasn't in the commandments. Thou shalt love thy neighbour as thyself. He slipped it in. I think the man was on automatic pilot, you know, the rich young ruler. Which commandments? Thou shalt not murder, tick, not murder. Thou shalt not commit adultery, tick, thou shalt not. And he's ticking them off. And love your neighbour as yourself. He says, I've kept all that. But he hadn't. That was where he slipped up, the love. Thou shalt not kill doesn't mention love, but love your neighbour as yourself, he slipped up. So he couldn't pay the price. And that's why people don't love their neighbour as yourself, it's costly. He couldn't do it. I've got 3 points. Number one, it's very costly. Number two, we can't use grace as an excuse. Christians say, yeah, but I've got grace, I'm all right, why do I have to do this, why do I have to do that? God's forgive me sins, I've got grace, you can't tell me how to live. Well, I can tell you how to live, and I'm going to tell you how to live. It's in the Bible, it tells us how to live, so I'm a teacher, so I've got to teach you how to live, because Christians don't know. They think they can live like the world and hide behind cheap grace, and you can't. You can't be a disciple unless you deny yourself and take up your cross. So I can tell you how to live. Galatians 5. We've got soft Christianity. Pastors are frightened to tell the church how they can live. So there's people sleeping together and not married. There's people doing all sorts of things. There's criticisms and bigotry and gossip in the church. And they're frightened to say that's not acceptable. You'll have to leave our church if you carry on. They're frightened to say it. They won't tell them how to live. But the Bible tells us how to live, and it's here, so I'm going to preach it. Galatians 5. Verse 13. For brothers, we've been called to liberty. We've got grace. We've been called to liberty. Hallelujah. Only don't use liberty for an occasion to the flesh. Don't use your liberty as an excuse. Don't lose the grace as an excuse. But by love, serve one another. So he's saying, it's confirming what I said. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this, thou shalt love thy neighbour as thyself. Don't use grace as an excuse. Don't use your liberty as an excuse to live in the flesh, to live a carnal, worldly lifestyle. Don't use it as an excuse. Because all the law's fulfilled in this, you'll love your neighbour as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, take heed you not be consumed one of another. This I say, walk in the spirit and you won't fulfil the lusts of the flesh. So that's quite strong, isn't it? Turn to St. John's Gospel. St. John chapter 13. So this is at the communion meal. Chapter 13 to 18, all red letter if you've got a red letter Bible. All Jesus' dialogue in the upper room. Some of it's when Judas is there. Much of it is when Judas has gone and it's to the 11, the foundation church. John 13, 34. Jesus said, a new commandment I give you. I give you a new commandment. As I have loved you, ye also love one another. Wow, that's strong. That doesn't say love your neighbour as yourself. That means die for one another. Christ loved us and laid down his life for us. So we've got to love our brothers and be willing to die for one another. Not betray one another when the pressure comes. Not gossip when you're misunderstood. A new commandment. This is a new commandment. He's not reiterating the old one. This is brand new. A new commandment I give you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that ye may love one another. By this will all men know that you're my disciples, if you have love like I had for you, one with another. That's strong, isn't it? And chapter 14, verse 23. Here we have the love and the action again. Faith and the action. Verse 23. Jesus answered and said, if a man love me, he will keep my words. If he loves me, he'll do what he says. If my children love me, they'll do what I say. If they don't love me, they'll be rebellious. I don't care what my dad says, I'm not doing it. But obedient children obey their parents. Obedient workers obey the boss. The Bible says obey those in authority. If a man love me, he'll keep my words, he'll do what I say, and my Father will love him. That implies that the Father won't love you if you won't do what Jesus said. And we will come unto him and make our abode in him. Two of them will come. We will come. I was listening to a man preaching last night, and he was saying Jesus and God are one. But Jesus is the Son. I know he had the fullness of the Godhead body, but he talked about me and my Father will come and dwell with you. He didn't say me, who is the Father, and my Father, who is me, will come and dwell. He's talking about me and my Father. We've now got a Father and a Son. He was in his Father, but now he's the Son. And we will come unto him and make our abode in him, plural, our. He that loveth me, he that loveth me not, keepeth not my sayings. If you don't love Jesus, you won't keep his sayings. And the words which you hear is not mine, but the Father's which sent me. It's not my words, it's my Father's. There's a separation there. There's a Son and a Father separate there. If you hear my words, they're not my words, they're my Father's. These have I spoken, being yet present with you. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things. So we can't use grace as an excuse. We have to love one another as Christ loved us. Number three, Israel failed to keep the moral law of God. Why did they fail? Let's read it, Romans 9. They could have kept it, you know. Some of them did. It says that Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist, was a righteous man. So he kept the moral law of God because he was right before God. He must have kept it by faith. Daniel was a righteous man. Job was a righteous man. People under the law, well, Job was perhaps before the law. But many people, Daniel was there, many people were righteous in their generation because they kept the moral law of God by faith. But Israel as a nation failed, and Romans tells us why. Romans chapter 9, verse 30. I can't look at the context. What shall we say then? That the Gentiles which followed not after righteousness have attained to righteousness. The Gentiles weren't seeking the moral law of God. We didn't know it. It wasn't given to us. We weren't given the Ten Commandments. They were given to Israel. It's not for the Gentiles. But we've attained to righteousness, the righteousness that is by faith. But Israel, which followed after the law of righteousness, they were given it, they were told to keep it, hath not attained to the law of righteousness. Wherefore? Why? How not? Because they sought it not by faith, but as it were the works of the law. For they stumbled at that stumbling stone. They kept it not by faith. But I can also say it's because they didn't love God. Because if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. So it's a lack of faith and a lack of love. You cannot separate the two. I've got a wonderful scripture in a minute. You can't separate faith and love. If you love your neighbour as yourself, it's very costly. And you only do it because you believe God. You do it by faith. And Israel lacked love and they lacked faith. And they didn't inherit the promise. And this is the scripture, Galatians. Because you may wonder why I'm reading about faith when it's about love. But they're inseparable. The principles are the same. And hopefully this will convince you. Galatians chapter 5. Stand fast therefore. This is from verse 1. Stand fast therefore in the liberty where Christ has made us free. Keep hold of that grace. There's nothing wrong with grace. I'm not preaching against grace. That's wonderful. We've got grace. But don't make it cheap. So stand fast in the liberty where Christ has made us free. And don't be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Don't go back under the law. Taste not, touch not, handle not. That's not the moral law of God. Taste not, touch not, handle not. That's a ceremonial law. Don't eat pork. Don't touch anything unclean. Don't. That's a ceremonial law. Don't touch, don't taste. We're not talking about the moral law of God. I can't understand how Christians get mixed up. Even Messianic Jews get all mixed up. And say, well, we should study the Torah and that's perfect. No, it's the moral law of God. Whenever he's talking about love and the law, it's always the moral law of God. And Paul said, you're freed from the ceremonial law. Don't be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Behold, I, Paul, say unto you, if you circumcise, Christ profits you nothing. Circumcision was the ceremonial law of God. For I testify, every man that is circumcised is a debtor to do the whole law. You have to keep the whole ceremonies. If you circumcise, you have to keep the feast, you have to have washing of pots, you have to have all those divers ordinances. And Christ has become no effect to you. Some of those people who are trying to get back to the Hebrew roots, Christ is non-effect to them because they're going back under the yoke of bondage. Christ has become no effect to you. Whosoever of you are justified by the law, you're fallen from grace. That's scary. For we through the Spirit wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. Now listen to this. For in Jesus Christ, neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but faith which worketh by love. Can you see how he's coupled them up together? Faith that works by love. How can faith work by love? Because faith is obeying God. Faith is hearing God and obeying. That's your faith. It's the action of what God told you. But it's because you love God. So it's faith which worketh by love. We only obey God because we love him. So he said, all that doesn't avail anything. Circumcision and keeping all the ceremonial laws and the feasts and all the special days and everything. And don't eat pork and don't do that. He says that doesn't avail you anything, but neither does uncircumcision. Neither does freedom, neither does cheap grace. There's only one thing that avails you, and it's this. Faith which worketh by love. Can you see, love fulfills the law? But you need faith to love, and you need love to be obedient. So for me, that's the fulcrum now of the whole study. Faith which works by love. Maybe you didn't understand why I was talking about faith when the subject's love, but you can't separate the two. If you love God, you obey him. And it takes faith. So, I've finished that part. Let's go back to the scripture, because there's some more to look at. I've one more study about love. Next studies about love. And then we'll look at one of the six examples that Jesus gave. We'll go through those six studies. But after he said, don't think I've come to destroy the law, I've come to fulfil it. Now you know you fulfil it by love. But verse 19 says, whosoever shall break one of these least commandments and teach men so. So those who say we don't need to keep that law, we've got grace, and teach men so, they're the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever teaches and does. For me, it's a very fundamental principle. It's the doing. It's not a teaching, it's not believing, it's the doing. Faith without works is dead. So we must teach and we must do. The end of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus gives an illustration of a man on the built house on the sand and a house on the rock. And it's not a gospel message, it's not about people building on the sand who are going to the lake of fire and people who are building on the rock, which is Jesus. The rock isn't Jesus in this illustration. Jesus tells you what the rock is. Building on the rock is here in the Sermon on the Mount. Whoever hears the words of these saying, that's the sermon he's just preached. So whoever hears the Sermon on the Mount and does it, you're building on the rock. Whoever hears the Sermon on the Mount and doesn't do it is building on sand. So it's not the hearers who are justified, but the doers. I'm not going to go back to James, but that's what James says. Not the hearers of the law are justified, but the doers of the law. And so it's saying the same thing. Whosoever shall break this moral law of God and teach men shall be least in the kingdom of heaven. But to teach and do. You see, teaching is by example. You can't take anyone further than you yourself have gone. I can't take you further than I'm willing to go. So if you want to go to London tonight, I live in Manchester, if you're listening around the world. I live in Manchester, central England. If I want to go to, you want to go to London, which is 200 miles away, and I'm only willing to take you halfway to Birmingham, you won't get there, will you? I can't take you further than I am willing to go. So that's why we teach, not by words, but by example. It's got to be by example. Teach and do. Teach and do. Hear and do. Well, are there any examples? Sure to have. Jesus lived with his disciples. Why do you think Jesus lived with them? Why didn't Jesus do what we do now? We have a Bible college, don't we? And the lecturer turns up 11 o'clock Monday morning for a lecture, gives an hour's lecture, and then says, see you. Goes home to his wife at night. Nobody knows how he lives. Could beat his wife for all they know. Jesus lived with his disciples. Why didn't he meet them every day for lectures and teaching? But he lived with them. They walked the roads together. They slept in the same place. Often they were staying at wealthy people's houses. They put them up, they ate meals together. Jesus went and ate a meal with the Pharisees and his disciples. They saw his lifestyle. You've got to teach by example. You can't separate yourself from the people you're teaching. The Greek way is to give knowledge, gnosis. Give them information, that's what we do. We teach people now, we give them information at school, we give them the information and they remember the invitation and regurgitate it back onto the paper and pass an exam. But that's not good teaching. Teaching is when you get alongside somebody and they see your example and you stay with them until they're doing it. And that's what Jesus did. He stayed with them 3 years. Paul did the same. He stayed at Ephesus 3 years and then he left them because he trained them. He saw they were living how he wanted them to. And when he came back later, let's go and see how they're doing. They were doing very well. And he said to Timothy, you're the first elder there. Paul's a good example to Timothy. I've given you his example of him staying at Ephesus and meeting them and people coming to his house. Paul always took an entourage round with him. He had John Mark, he had Barnabas, he had Luke with him. People with him all the time training them. Timothy, 2 Timothy 3. This is what Paul said. Verse 10, you fully know my doctrine. Doctrine is teaching. This is a Greek word, means teaching. You've known my teachings, manner of life. You know all about me. You know my lifestyle. You don't only know my teaching, you know my lifestyle, my manner of life, my purpose, my faith, my long-suffering. You've seen my long-suffering. You've seen my charity, my compassion. You've seen my patience. How can you see somebody's patience if they give you a lecture and then go home? You've got to live with somebody to find if they're patient. You've got to live with somebody to find if they've got compassion. Persecutions, afflictions. He said, you've seen them all. You know my manner of life, which came to me at Antioch, Iconium, Lystra. What persecutions I endured, but out of them all the Lord delivered me. And all that will live godly shall suffer persecution. But there's Paul with his example. I've taught you, but you know my doctrine, my manner of life. You've seen my lifestyle. Christianity is a lifestyle. It's not what you believe. We've made it a religion where you have to believe certain things. But Christianity is a way of living, and the Bible and the Sermon on the Mount is a manifesto to tell us how to live. Woe betide a Christian that doesn't study it and live it. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. Verse 14. I write these things not to shame you, but as my beloved sons, I warn you, for though you have 10,000 instructors in Christ, many people could come and tell you things, many people could give you a lecture and instruct you, and there's nothing wrong with that. But you have not many fathers. Fathers are those who care for the children who live with them. For in Christ Jesus I've begotten you through this gospel. You're my children, I've looked after you. Wherefore, I beg you, be followers of me. Follow my example because I'm your father. If a father doesn't live with his children, how can they follow his example? How can he be a follower of your father if he's off in some foreign land? You can't. You can only follow your father when you live with him. He's saying, follow me. You're my children. I've begotten you. You're the ones I look after you. You've got 10,000 people who'll come and preach to you. 10,000 people who'll give you good doctrines. But you've only got one father. You're my children in the faith. Follow me. And chapter 11. This is what Paul says. Was he bragging? Was he cocky? No, he understood the principle that children are supposed to follow the fathers. Be ye followers of me, even as I am of Christ. See, Paul was willing to say, look, don't just listen to my words, follow me. He was teaching and doing, teaching and living the life as an example. And then we go back to verse 20 of Matthew 5, because I'm going to speak about love next study, but I've finished on this passage. Verse verse 20. I say to you, except your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, you shall no case enter the kingdom of heaven. You cannot reign with Christ. You can't have the kingdom when Jesus comes unless your righteousness exceeds the Pharisees, because they were God's children, but they heard and did not. Jesus often said, obey them because they teach in Moses' law. But don't follow after what they do, because they teach and do not. We've got to exceed that. We've got to hear and do. It's not talking about salvation and, well, our righteousness exceeds it because we've got the righteousness of Christ. It's not talking about that. It's talking about the law. People have taken it out of context when they said, well, how can our righteousness exceed the Pharisees? Well, we've got salvation by grace. Nothing to do with that. It's talking about the doing. They preached but didn't live it. They had to a heart. They were hypocrites, but they taught the law of Moses. We've got to not only teach the Bible, we've got to live it. Matthew 7:21. I won't say much about this because it's a Sermon on the Mount. We'll look at it in depth. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, 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 Lord. So these are people who are following Jesus, or think they are. They won't enter the kingdom of heaven, because Jesus says unless your righteousness exceed it, you won't see the kingdom of heaven. Who'll get into the kingdom of heaven? He that doeth the will of God. That's action. That's works. Doing the will of God is works. That's not faith, is it? He didn't say you get to the kingdom by faith. Salvation is by faith. The kingdom is by works, how you live. There's got to be a distinction. Christians don't know the difference. Because salvation is by free and it's grace and it's nothing to do with you, they think that the kingdom's the same. Salvation gives you eternal life. It doesn't give you the kingdom. You've got to work for the kingdom. There's so many instructions. The humble will inherit the kingdom. The meek will inherit the earth. There's so many rules and regulations for the kingdom. So not everyone that says, Lord, Lord, will get into the kingdom. It doesn't say they won't have eternal life. But they won't get the kingdom. Only those that do the will, the doers. Many will say to me, Lord, we've prophesied in your name. We've shown all your power, done wonderful works. I don't know you. You that work iniquity. They weren't doing the right works. The works are not showing the power of God. The works are the lifestyle, the character of God, the Sermon on the Mount. But the outward's not wrong. Matthew 23. It's got to be ruled by love. It's got to be done by faith and love. But the outward in itself is not wrong. Matthew 23. Well, from verse 1, then Jesus spoke to the multitude and to his disciples, saying, the scribes and the Pharisees, this is to confirm what I've said, sit in Moses' seat. They represent the moral law of God. All therefore whatsoever they bid you observe, that observe and do. But do not ye after their works. Do them, do the right works, but don't do their works. For they say and do not. For they bind heavy burdens and grievous to be borne and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with their little finger. They don't love the neighbour as themselves. They do the outward works, but there's no love. The heart's hard. But all their works they do to be seen of men. This isn't faith that works by love. And so he goes on. They love the uppermost. It's all to do with the outward. And there's no inward. There's no faith. There's no love. So the outward is not wrong. But it's got to be by faith. It's got to be by love. And then verse 23. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. You pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin. And have omitted the weightier matters of the law. Mercy, judgment and faith. These you ought to have done and not leave the other undone. He's not criticising them for keeping the law diligently, but he's saying the important parts of the law are love, mercy and judgment. And you've missed them out. You've not got into the kingdom because you had no love and no faith. Titus chapter 3, verse 4. But after the kindness and love of God, our Saviour, towards man appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us, by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, he's talking to Gentiles, which he shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Saviour, that being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. So he's preaching grace, wonderful. This is a faithful saying, and these things I will that thou affirm constantly, that they which believe in God, those who are saved by grace, those who believe in God, might be careful to maintain good works. These things are good and profitable unto men. Maintain good works. If you've got grace, don't use it as an excuse not to love your neighbour as yourself. So, unless our motives and desires have been radically changed, we'll be frightened of works. We'll say, oh, that's dead works, brother. Or we'll do works with the wrong motive and become hypocrites. We've got to have that love and that faith. So, unless we keep the law by unassuming love, we become hypocrites. And sooner or later, we'll crucify Christ afresh. Is that a strong statement? Yes, it is. You see, it was the hypocrites who crucified Jesus. They lacked love. They were hard. And so when Jesus, who demonstrated the love of God, that was the blinding light, came to the earth, they crucified him. So when you lack love and you lack faith, you become hard, you become bigoted, and you'll crucify Christ afresh, and you'll criticize and burn people at the stake who have different doctrines. You become hard. Well, there's one little point before we go from this study. It says, till heaven and earth pass, not one jot or one tittle will fail from all the law. And he's talking about the moral law, not the ceremonial. Well, a jot and a tittle, a jot is a letter of the Hebrew alphabet. And a tittle is just like an exclamation mark, a comma, a full stop. The little tiny bits of the law. Not one full stop, not one comma, not one little word, an and, will be fail of the law till all's fulfilled. So, till heaven and earth pass, when will that be? When Jesus comes, no. Heaven and earth don't pass when Jesus comes. When the rapture comes, no. Heaven and earth hasn't passed. When Jesus has reigned for 1,000 years, getting close. So there's a long time for the law to be here. Jesus hasn't come yet, so there's at least 1,000 years. So there's 1,000 years plus. After 1,000 years, Satan's loose, so I don't know how long that will take. For him to gather all the armies of the world, it may take 6 months or 60 years, I don't know. There'll be a defeat, and then God will destroy the earth. Heaven and earth will pass away. And only then will this law of God finish. The moral law of God will be finished in eternity. There'll be no moral law of God in eternity. You won't need a moral law because there'll be no tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So until heaven and earth pass, the moral law of God will stand. Not one jot or tittle will fail. And woe betide anyone who hides behind grace and said it's finished. Till heaven and earth pass. That's after the millennium. Maybe I'll just read it, Revelation 21. I found that Christians don't know much about the end times. They don't know much about the new heaven, the new earth. They seem to think we'll all end up in heaven playing our harps or something, but Nobody's going to live in heaven forever with God. God's going to live on earth, the new earth, with us forever. He will dwell with us, not we will dwell with him. Read it. Revelation 21. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and earth were passed away. So that's the moral law gone. Till heaven and earth pass. So the first were passed away. The moral law finishes that day. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven say, behold, the tabernacle, the dwelling place of God, is with men. And he will dwell with them. So God's going to dwell with us on this new earth. We'll never end up in heaven. And they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them. Not we'll be with him, he'll be with them. And shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. Wonderful. That's when it'll happen. And chapter 22. Great separation. Verse 11. He that's unjust, let him be unjust still, forever, eternity. He which is filthy, let him be filthy for eternity. He that's righteous, let him be righteous forever. There's a gap. There's no moral law anymore because it's fixed. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me. Jesus is coming with his reward. We've got to account for deeds done in the body, according to Paul. So let me finish there. These studies, I imagine, are difficult for people if they've never been exposed to this type of teaching. And have only had grace and never known that we have to work for our reward. You can't work for grace. But if you get a reward, it's not a gift. It's for work. Otherwise, it's a gift. You can't work for the gifts of the Spirit. They're gifts, severally as he wills. But you work for rewards, and Jesus is coming with his reward. So you need to establish, if it's, this is all confusing to you, you need to establish salvation's by grace, no works. The kingdom reigning with Christ is by works, not grace. Study it. I'm hoping to explain more as we go along, but it's fundamental and I don't hear it being taught. So my conclusion, it's impossible not to establish the law when we love. Love fulfills the law. So it's impossible not to do. All you need to do is love. Forget the law. You don't even need to know the moral law of God. If you love God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, your strength, if you love your neighbour as yourself, don't worry. You'll fulfil all the moral law of God. Wonderful, isn't it? All we have to do is love. John Lennon was right, wasn't he? No idea what love was, but he said all we need is love. He was right. He didn't know what it was. But the statement was right, that's all we need. So Lord, please help us. Teach us how to love. Teach us how to have faith, Father. Teach us how to demonstrate we love and demonstrate we have faith by our lifestyle, not by our talk. God forbid we should hide behind religion, hide behind grace, hide behind our denomination. Lord, teach us how to live this victorious Christian life, full of faith and love. Amen. Well, God bless you. Have a wonderful week. Next week, I've got an interesting study called The Motives of Love. God bless you all.